like a rubber ball. Everyone in radio has a story about his or her young fascination with this incredible medium. Some of us will even tell you about the irony of our present as it relates to our past. We're the ones with the most pinch marks on our arms. Glancing back, we still can't believe that we made it to the other side of that microphone. Well, this story begins at a concession stand at the Coliseum in San Antonio. It was 1964, my summer between high school and college. My mom had seen an article in the paper about a teen fair of Texas that would feature many of my favorite recording stars. The lineup included Bobby Vinton, Roses Are Red, Leslie Gore, It's My Party, Paul Peterson, My Dad, and many more. But the name that really got my attention was a singer that I not only impersonated, I idolized. Bobby V. I had to meet him. He was riding high on the charts at the time with songs like The Night Has a Thousand Eyes and Taking Care of My Baby. And as a young comedian impressionist, his was one of the first singing voices I learned to impersonate. Well, the next day, at my mom's suggestion, moms always come up with the best ideas at just the right time, I went down to the Coliseum and got a job making lemonade for the 10 days of the fair. I was so excited, I didn't even ask how much it paid. I didn't care. I knew there would be backstage press parties prior to each performance, and this job would be my ticket to get in. I explained to the kind lady who hired me that I also had a show on WSAC Radio that I wanted to get some interviews for and pictures with the performers. Well, since she was in charge of catering the affairs, she agreed to make arrangements, especially when I mentioned getting her in some of the pictures. Well, what I didn't tell her was that WSAC was the station at San Antonio College, where I was about to attend, that broadcasted to the cafeteria. When the day came for Bobby's matinee performance, like Clark Kent, I quickly transformed myself from lemonade boy into super radio guy. Armed with my portable tape recorder and wearing my graduation suit, I headed to the stage area. There was one small problem. My boss was sick that day and consequently not there to get me in. Without her, I would need a ticket. I didn't have a ticket. I had to think fast. I did have a gift for Bobby. It was a charcoal drawing that I had sketched the night before of his latest album cover. Without a ticket or backstage pass, I was sunk, unless I could create a credential. On the back of one of my cards, actually the card left over from my graduation invitations, I wrote, "This young man has been commissioned to sketch my portrait. Please let him in. Signed, Bobby V," and handed it to one of the Boy Scouts checking tickets, who questioned, "Did he really write this?" I looked at him with confident disbelief and said, "Give me that," as I grabbed the card out of his hand and walked right on in. Nothing was going to keep me from my mission. Leslie Gore was in the middle of her set when I casually walked up to the side of the stage and said to the security guard who was standing between me and the curtain leading backstage, "Looks like we have a pretty good crowd today." Now is playing the part of one of the promoters. As he slowly nodded, I recognized the woman standing next to him. It was Leslie's mother. "I'm going to get a chair for Mrs. Gore," I announced before walking through the backstage curtain and returning with a folding chair, which I presented to a very grateful lady. Nonchalantly, I walked back through the curtain, down the hall, into the room where the press conference would be held, and waited for the star of the show to arrive. What I hadn't bargained for was another act showing up early. They were a group from England and so unknown to U.S. audiences that they were billed as Friends of the Beatles. Now, mind you, the press and the real DJs had not yet arrived. So there I was trying to make conversation with these blokes in this little backstage dressing room holding a microphone and just enough tape, I thought, to interview Bobby V. Finally, I broke down and pushed the record button. "So, how do you like Texas?"
"It's hot."
"Who's your favorite Beatle?"
"George."
Does that hamburger taste good?"
"Yeah."
Hey, this is my first interview. Ever. Finally, Bobby V and his entourage arrived. And he was about as gracious as any artist could be, given that I was just a kid in the middle of all this legitimate media. He answered every question I asked with the same respect he had given Dick Clark on American Bandstand the week before. I handed him the charcoal sketch, got his autograph, and went back to making lemonade. A short decade later, after my diligence and love for radio had taken me to Los Angeles and KMPC, one of America's truly great radio stations, it was there that I came across a new record by a country artist named Robert Thomas Valeen, a.k.a. Bobby V. I immediately called the record company to set up an interview. Bobby's top 40 fame had come and gone, and he had moved back to his hometown, Fargo, North Dakota. When he found out about my interest in his music, he actually drove to L.A. in his van for the interview. Yes, the kid to whom he had shown a little kindness only 10 years earlier was now in a position to help him. I produced and recorded the interview into a 2-hour radio special featuring his new music and all of his big hits. After the session, we lunched at Cyrano's Restaurant on the Sunset Strip, courtesy of the record company. I ordered lemonade and shared my memory with a most appreciative veteran performer. Well, today, Bobby remains a good friend and tours year-long, bringing delight to fans around the world. You might say that what goes around comes bouncing back to you. Oh, and by the way, I later found out that the English group that I had chatted with backstage at the time was making their maiden voyage to the States, and San Antonio had been one of the stops. With my little reel-to-reel tape recorder, and without knowing it, I had been among the first in America to interview Mick Jagger and the Rolling Stones.